Hello, welcome to another edition of Focus On with Hugo Thold
and Ian Horson.
And this time we're at Dry Sanford.
The oldest rocks at Dry Sanford are actually below the quarry floor, but they can be observed at the edge of the fen. They are calcarenite, which is a cemented sandstone, and they're highly fossiliferous. These fossils include Trigonia.
The next bed up in the sequence is at the base of this main face. Today, it is very heavily bioturbated by organisms such as badgers, bees and wasps, which like making their homes in it because the sandstone is very unconsolidated, making it easier for them to burrow into. The grains of the sandstone itself are very well sorted, clean and mature, indicating its extensive transport before it was deposited in this location.
The base of this bed is non-conformable with the one below it. It's marked by a horizon of pebbles, which represent high energy deposition. The rest of the unit grades from a highly fossiliferous arenite to a pure oomycrite. This is probably due to a change in sedimentary pathways rather than an actual change in sea level.
This next unit is another sandy layer which fits in well with the interbedded siliciclastic and carbonate regime we're starting to identify. The coarse grains and fossil fragments we can see indicate a higher energy depositional environment than that seen in bed 2.
The ammonites in this bed are in the antecedent subzone, while the one below them are in the vertebralis subzone. This implies there's been a very large length of time between the two beds. However, the amount of sediment between the two is very small, which implies a very low sedimentation rate. At the base of this bed, some of the best fossils can be found, including nucleites echinoids and perisphincted ammonites.
This next layer is another unconsolidated brown shelly sandstone with an impersistent band of white limestone running through it. Above this horizon, the bivalves become less and less fragmented, indicating a decrease in the environmental energy.
This bed is a coarse limestone, representing a return to calcareous deposition conditions. It's unfossiliferous, with a recrystallized spiry matrix, and has been extensively altered by pedogenic processes.
The penultimate bed in the sequence, and the last bed we're looking at this time at Dry Sanford, is the urchin marls. The high fossil content of this bed indicates a shallow and well-oxygenated environment. Primarily siliciclastic, it does have some oolitic material which suggests it was less than 5 metres of water, shallow enough to form ooids.